Libby Gill, who is the CEO of Libby Gill & Company, which is an executive coaching and consulting firm, is going to be presenting to us. Libby works with a variety of companies, Disney ABC, eBay, Kellogg's, Microsoft. She has worked with Sony and Universal and Turner Broadcasting, and I'm told that she was the branding brain behind the Dr. Phil show. So she really has quite an interesting background in that regard. I'm very happy to welcome Libby to the stage. Libby Gill.
Happy to be here today, and I'm actually here to talk about what Old Spice, James Bond, and the Association of Engineering and Technology Professionals of Alberta, Canada have in common. I bet you never thought you would hear those three entities in the same sentence, right? Because branding is a very broad topic. But I want to kick this off by making it super simple and think of branding as simply a promise of value. It is simply a pledge, a promise, a commitment of value that you as leaders and your association as an organization pledged to your members. So what we're going to talk about is how your value and your association value overlap and where that brand intersects. What is meaningful to your brand today may not work for your brand tomorrow. So it's critical that you think of your brand in a forward-moving fashion. So what I'm really here to talk about today is relevance. How you make your brand relevant and how it continues to build relevance for future members, for customers and clients you may not even have yet. Now, I'll share a little bit from my own career. You heard a little bit about my Hollywood career, but I actually started my career in Hollywood working for a little production and distribution company that was founded, if you're American and you know TV, by a legendary sitcom producer named Norman Lear, who brought us All in the Family and many other shows. It was a great little company, and I thought, what a treat to get in, work in this mid-sized company and have a hand in everything. And then that was very quickly bought by Columbia Pictures, which was owned by Coca-Cola, which then sold it to Sony Pictures Television. So all of a sudden, this little company became this huge entity. But I rode that wave, and I, just by raising my hand and figuring it out later, went from being a PR assistant in that small company to being named Vice President of Publicity, Advertising, and Promotion for Sony's Worldwide Television Group. And what I learned in those years, and I went on from Sony to Turner Broadcasting and to Universal, and what I found was especially important as I was building brands for the studio and for the celebrities and for the television shows that I represented was that I also built a brand for myself as a leader. At first, not so intentionally. Later on, very much by design. And as I went up that ladder, I began to build this brand as a communicator who could really see around obstacles, get people inspired to jump on board and move into this future vision, which was particularly useful when I got to Universal because the company had just gone through this huge management change. It had been bought by Seagram, which was headquartered right here in Montreal. And I think the Seagram property is now part of McGill University here. But the company was then owned partly by Matsushita, a Japanese company. And Lou Wasserman was the famous chairman. He was called the last mogul. 50 years he'd been at the helm of Universal and its predecessor company, MCA. And he ran with an iron fist. It really invented much of the modern motion picture and television business. But by that point, many years later, so much of the business had changed, and the studio was in constant conflict with the parent company. Competition was just always hammering away, and Universal was in sort of a creative free fall. And when I came in post-Seagram, which no one could quite figure out, my job was to explain that to the media and consumers, exactly what that global beverage entertainment company mix was. And then what we found was The people were very, the studio was very stable, but the people were very siloed, having been long-term employees and lots of historical feuds and fiefdoms and all those things that happen with sometimes with a long management span. So when I came in with the head of the television group as part of this new wave, every business unit had changed. Music and motion pictures and theme parks, all of those had new people at the helm in a span of less than 18 months. So people were reeling with the changes, and we were trying to, not to reestablish the company to its glory days, because the business had changed so much. Now it was about summer blockbusters and mega talent deals and emerging cable channels. CTAM over there, yes, know you well. So everything had changed in the industry. What we had to do was reinvent, take the company back to a level of relevance so people could see what we were doing. And as head of media relations and communications, I saw it very much as my job to get out there and paint that picture, to reestablish us as a creative force. Only problem was, nobody much cared about me coming in with the new wave, or let alone what my mission was, but I was undeterred. I got in my little golf cart, which is how you travel around a 500-acre back lot. If you've ever been to Universal Studios, you know it's vast. And I went out and met face-to-face with anybody that would spend 10 minutes with me. So I met with HR and accounting and the on-air talent. I'll never forget Angela Lansbury was in a production office two blocks away, but it was drizzling, rare in California, so she sent her limo to pick me up. Now, if you don't think times have changed, that was definitely someone from the old days. It was so lovely and gracious. But I went out and met with all of these people, and people began to see that we were meant to connect and create and to share a purpose, as John talked about so much this morning, a purpose and a mission. And when I began to hear the media, that was my main customer. I was always translating, well, both internal communications, but also the external, as you said, you clarify the internal and communicate it out. And when I began to hear the media and see in print, the sleeping giant, which is what they called Universal, has awakened, then I knew we were on the right track. We'd been restored to a level of relevance again. Three steps that I think to creating a powerful brand. It's not as mysterious or as complicated as a lot of marketers and branders would like us to think. The first, and we heard a lot about this morning from John, is defining your purpose. And as Arlene said, go back to your original charter, your articles of incorporation. Why are you here in the first place? What's your purpose? Second is determine those pillars. What are the actions and deliverables that support your brand? What do you do every day? And finally, and this is where it gets fun, describe your personality. Who are you? What do you bring that's unique and absolutely true to who you are? So first, let's look at that idea of purpose. And again, what Arlene said was critical. Why are you here? Why do you even exist? And I don't need to tell you as association folks that associations go back to medieval times. I mean, they've been around forever, not always for the noblest of purposes in centuries past, but certainly now with the level of transparency and the service that you do, you not only serve your members, but often you are directly serving the public. So think about that purpose, and I encourage you to nail that down to 7 words or less. Shouldn't be a page, shouldn't be an article. I'll share my 3-word purpose with you in just a bit. And second, the brand pillars. What is it that you do? What actions do you take when you are consistently using your skills, the best and highest use of your time and talent? And this should be by design. It should be very intentional, down to a percentage of the time that you spend, whether it's influencing regulation, creating a unified voice for your industry, setting the educational, the certification, the professional standards. And now, obviously, there are lots of people involved in all of those different steps, but you as leaders, where do you spend your time? And what is the percentage of time that you spend on those high-value activities? I spoke to one association leader who told me, well, you know, it's fundraising. For me, it's all about fundraising. That's my main job. And once he was very clear and focused on that, he moved his office so he would be away from the scrum so he could think and strategize. And whenever he came up with a meeting was canceled or he had an extra 10 minutes, he was on a donor call. And he said when he became very crystal clear on fundraising was his mission, he stopped taking out the trash. And I mean that literally. He stopped cleaning up after other people. He stopped spending his time on things that didn't matter, focused on those high-level activities. And then finally, there's your personality. There may be half a dozen of you that serve the same population through your associations. But what you do by virtue of being you is absolutely different. And we touched on that this morning. John talked about differentiation. Critical. But I agree with him so much. It's not the big, you know, we do this differently. It's something that is so deep in your heart and soul that you may not even say it out loud. It may be something in your private mythology that you know is what you're better at than just about anybody you know. And it's so hard for us to put words around that because most people are humble to a fault, and I mean to a fault, because we gloss over what we're good at. We take it for granted or we assume everybody else does it too. But that's not true. So I'm going to ask you in a minute to really think about that personality that you have. What do you uniquely bring to the table in a way that no one else can? And how do you build language out of that? And how do you take something that's sort of this internal mantra and have some fun with it and put it out into the world? I'll share some of that, but first I want to give you a little bit of the data, a little background research, and you may know this brand, but I want to give you a good, broad research view, and think about the brand purpose, the pillars, and the personality as you review this with me. James Bond is a great example of these three pieces. What is the, think, put yourself in 007 mindset. What is the purpose? What is James Bond's, the 007 mission? It, yes, to sell movie tickets for sure, but anybody remember why James Bond is out there doing his thing? You probably know.
Get rid of evil.
Get rid of evil, specifically in the name of?
Queen.
Well, who is the evil? The Queen, yes. The evil organization, Spectre, thank you. Yes, Spectre, that's the purpose, yes. He's protecting the queen, and he's getting rid of evil, which is, of course, Spectre. Now, think about the pillars of the brand. What are the consistent deliverables? I mean, even when you heard that theme song and you saw the camera, you knew exactly what it was. Even maybe even before that, with the MGM lion roaring, you knew exactly what to expect from James Bond. What are some of those action deliverables that you would consider pillars of the James Bond brand, why you'd spend your, I don't know what it is here, 15 bucks, 12 bucks to buy a ticket?
Daredevils.
Daredevils, yes, always the action, always the aerial scenes, great action scenes, what else? Aston Martin, yes, although the cars have changed through the years, yes. You've seen that Aston Martin for years. What did you say, technology? Gadgets, right? Really fun, crazy gadgets, what else? Sophistication? I'd put that in the personality side, but absolutely. Who else?
Women.
There. I'm sure this says nothing about your CEO's focus, but yes. Women. Yes.
Martinis.
Martinis. Yes. You expect all of these things. Anything else? We've got international locations. Yeah.
Cunning.
Personality, again. Now, the action items are those deliverables. It's what you as a leader do. It is what we expect a James Bond film to do, right? The action scenes, the all of the gadgets, the Aston Martin. But now think about it for a minute. Some of those things you could say about Star Wars, right? You could say beautiful women, action sequences, crazy gadgets, even the locations, although they're more galactic than they are international, those are all Star Wars. But it is because of the personality that you could see even a 10-second clip and know it was Star Wars, or a 10-second clip and know it was James Bond. And that goes back to, who said cunning? Cunning, yes, cunning, exactly. And what did you say? sophistication, there's a cheekiness, a sexiness, the clothes, the look and feel, right? That all is part of the James Bond personality. And you can argue the social relevance or the, you know, the treatment of women or anything you want to argue in terms of political correctness. But the James Bond franchise, it's made $7 billion to date. And one thing you always know is that the personality is so true, even when they hearken back to the Aston Martin. The clothes change, the watches change, the music goes all the way from Shirley Bassey in the old days, Paul McCartney, Adele. All of that changes so that if you look at one of those films from the 70s or the 80s, and there now have been 26 of them since 1963, it's frozen in time. It is relevant, pure in that time period, right? Just like it is today. And the interesting thing now, if you follow the gossip magazines, which thank goodness I don't have to anymore now that I'm no longer in the business, is they are looking for an African-American James Bond. But he must be British. Has to be true to the brand core, and that is British. So they are changing with the times, and we'll see what happens next. The franchise clearly is not going away. So my question for you to think about is, how do you stay relevant in a world that is changing, even the nature of change? Next week, I'm going to do a keynote on the future of leadership. And one of my theses is that change is changing. It's faster. It's more complex. We have moving parts, more moving parts than ever before. We have to adapt to a world of constant change. We can't stay the same. And some of our favorite brands. Anybody got a favorite brand that's just disappeared? I loved my flip cam. Blockbuster, flip cam, Borders went away. And some of the things you can do to maintain relevance, to stay relevant in this ever-changing world where you can't really see around all those corners. And if you've got thousands of members, which I guess all of you do, it's very hard to figure out what they want next. Go back to your vision. As Arlene said, go all the way back. Why are you here? Was there a reason to be in the first place? What is the cause you're rallying around? And what is the problem that you solve for people? Revisit that. Tweak it, change it, bring it up to date. Make sure you can articulate it to everyone. Another thing, of course, is to experiment with new platforms. I mean, you can, when somebody says to me, and I'm sorry if I'm going to insult anybody in the room, if you don't have a smartphone, I would say raise your hand, but I don't want to embarrass anybody. You have to have a smartphone. When I work with branding clients, first of all, the people, even individual business owners, need to have an email address with their own name. But if they have an AOL address, I'm sorry. That means you got that address 20 years ago and you've never updated it. So you've got to experiment with new platforms. Look what happened to Borders Books. Borders, great, those were my two stops, Barnes & Noble and Borders. Borders was so late to the online party. Barnes & Noble's just had it all over them. And of course, they couldn't even hope to compete with the juggernaut of all e-commerce, which of course is Amazon, now drone deliveries. Fascinating what's coming next. So you've got to be experimenting with new platforms. And over here, if you're all in the same seats, you talked about having students on your association, in your volunteer, on your panels. I think that's so brilliant. Those are tomorrow's leaders of the organization. I spoke at an event recently, a couple years ago, it was a financial group, and it was their last conference, 86-year-old organization, and I was the last keynote speaker. They did not go out of business because of my keynote. I want you to understand that. But it was their last year in existence, and they said, we just aged out. We didn't see it coming. We didn't bring new people with us. They weren't looking for people in the places that people now hang out. That's what you've got to be doing. And of course, with that comes taking big risks. We heard about that from John this morning too. You've got to be taking risks. You've got to be trying new things. No, you're probably not going to bet the association on your student who's, you know, 2 years into college, but you've got to start letting your people take bigger risks, and you've got to be trying new things yourself. If you're not occasionally failing, then you're not stretching enough. And then finally, and this is a counterintuitive, so go out on this limb with me here. You've got to explore the shadows. You've got to look at the problems and the dark side, The weakness is to see where your real strength is. We got onto a Steve Jobs tangent this morning, which you sort of can't avoid throwing Apple into any discussion about brand or leadership. But the dark side of Steve Jobs, who was so brilliant and so interesting, look, there have been half a dozen films made about him by now, this dark side of being absolutely obsessed, not with just great technology, but with aesthetic beauty. And I drank the Kool-Aid. I'm a total Mac. I've got the desktop, the laptop, the iPhone, the iPad, usually all with me, minus the desktop. But we are fanatics about products. But it, so much of that brilliance came out of that dark side. Another one, just recently, we've heard so much about the passing of Muhammad Ali. Look at someone who was so controversial and so full of conviction about his passion. And yet, that brand was very much built out of that conviction that cost him a title. And this happens in our personal lives as well. And I'll share a story from my own life that I don't tell very often, but it seemed really relevant with sort of digging to the core of who you are as a leader. This is my family, and this may speak volumes, but that's as close to a family picture as we've ever gotten. Individual headshots of my siblings. I was one of six kids and grew up in Florida. Any Floridians in the room? In northern Florida, which is in Florida, the Canadians and the tourists are in the deep south. In the southern part of the state, the real deep south is at the Georgia border where I was, a little town outside of Jacksonville, Florida. And I grew up in my dad was a very prominent doctor. We were fairly privileged. We had a nice life with the big house on the riverfront and the boat and the tennis court and private schools and cotillion. And if you don't know what that is, you'll have to Google it. Cotillion, until Christmas Day when I was 10 years old. And on that day, which I'll never forget, my siblings and I all ran into the kitchen, you know, ready to open our presents. And there was a neighbor who let us know that our parents were at the hospital with my oldest brother, David, who was home from his Christmas break from his freshman year at Princeton. That's me, by the way, the cute one on the bottom left over there, that's me. So anyway, what our neighbor told us was that David had been in a car accident and our parents were at the hospital with him. What I found out many years later, I wrote a book called Traveling Hopefully about letting go of baggage of the past and moving into the future. And when I wrote that book, I told some family stories and I decided I better fact check this with my mom. So just imagine fact checking with your mother stories that your family has spent 40 years not talking about. So that's what I did, and I found out that my dad had taken my brother David out to lunch on Christmas Eve day, told him he was about to divorce our mom of 23 years and six children, and my brother went out to a party that night, apparently drank too much, lost control of the car on a curve coming home, and he, in fact, did die on Christmas Day. And my dad, true to his word, left my mom 3 months later and the five of us kids. And my dad left to marry a patient. I didn't mention my dad was a psychiatrist who married his own psychiatric patient in a little southern town in the 1960s. This did not go over well, as you can imagine. And my dad, then a two-year court battle ensued. He ended up moving to Japan with his new family, and I spent my adolescence sort of going back and forth from Jacksonville to Japan. Until the day, finally, we moved to California. Everybody moved back to Florida, and I said, that's it. I've gone to six high schools in 6 years. I am staying here. Whatever town this is where I am. I got a job as a waitress. I got an apartment, put myself through college, got a degree in theater, really useful minor in modern dance. Anyway, on the day I was about to start that big job with Norman Lear, my first real entertainment job, grown-up job with insurance, the whole bit, my dad called me in the middle of the night. My stepmom, Fran, had taken an overdose of Seconal and scotch and committed suicide while my dad was asleep in the next room. I proceeded to go home. My dad had disinherited all the other siblings, everyone but me. I was sort of sole survivor. I went back home and did what you do and what many of you have done. I cleaned out the closets. I did all of that stuff, planned the funeral, and gave away all of her Fran's possessions, except the one thing my father could not bear to part with. And so I ended up coming back to California with my stepmom's full-length mink coat, with a little matching hood, exactly what a 20-something in Southern California needs. And I dutifully took it home, put it back in the closet, forgot all about it, went back to work and just worked and worked and worked and worked until one day, in utter despair, loneliness, no connection with the family, I thought, you know, in the way young people do, I'm gonna go in the kitchen, pour a big glass of something. I think I found a bottle of brandy. I wasn't a big drinker back then. I took my bottle of brandy and I went into the bedroom and I thought, hey, I haven't tried on that mink coat. I think I'll give that a go. And I'd never tried on a fur in my entire life, but I took that thing out of the closet, put it on, and the first thing I thought was how heavy that was, how luxurious and how decadent. And I wondered how many dead animals did it take to make that one fur for this one sad woman. And that thought just killed me. I sank to my knees. I crawled literally into the hallway of my apartment, my little Hollywood apartment, and I stayed there wrapped in my mink coat with my bottle of brandy for 2 full days, crying my eyes out. And at some point, it hit me that I had 2 choices. Like, stay down on the floor, literally or metaphorically, for the rest of your life, or get your ass up and get back out there. And the moment I thought that, it was like these, I don't know what you believe, God, spirit, universe, karma, but it was like arms coming through those sleeves and lifting me up, back to your feet, get up off the ground. And I got up, and this other second thought hit me, and it was hope and tools. And I heard this phrase that even I thought was crazy, and that's saying something, hope and tools, hope and tools. But it was this idea, you got hope and tools, that's what your job is. And for many years, I had no idea what that meant, but as a leader, I felt like I gotta rally my staff. Entertainment was tough. You know, you put on a suit of armor and you go in there and fight every day. And if you don't like it, the motto is, there's someone younger and cheaper than you are. Don't let the door hit you on the butt on the way out. That was just how we worked. Not a lot of fun, but my job was to make it fun and exciting and to provide those tools and strategy and leadership for my kids. And I always had the youngest, biggest staff. So it gave me a great opportunity to develop and grow people, and that's what I did. And so my challenge to you is to take that inner brand. What is that thought in your head that you know that you are authentically so good at that you can identify? You might not ever say it out loud, but what is that? And as I went on in my career and then started my coaching, no surprise, what I wanted to do was help people grow. Career acceleration, that was what I was all about. Done with hope and tools. I discovered a body of science called hope theory, this emerging body of science. The derivation of the word hope, it comes from Old English, it means to leap forward with expectation, which was a good framework for me. And then I discovered this body of science that comes out of positive psychology in the medical communities. And there's a man named Dr. Jerome Groopman, wrote an amazing book. He writes all the time, he's a New Yorker science editor. And he wrote a book called How Doctors Think most recently. But he also wrote a book called The Anatomy of Hope. And he and other people I discovered are the pioneers of this theory, which two key components are, first, a fundamental belief that change is possible. Now you think, oh yeah, of course change is possible. We all think that, right? But think about someone in your life who is that defender of the status quo, who says things like, it is what it is. You can't fight City Hall. Those are the non-believers of change. Those are people that think, this is it, and it's a lot safer to stay here. But if you believe that change is possible, and then the secondary thought is an expectation that what you do as an individual, it's not regulations, it's not government, it's not climate, it is what you do every day. The actions that you take drive the outcome. That's it. Change is possible, I drive the outcome. I put an ebook that I've written about hope theory, I'm expanding to a book, on my website if anybody wants it. It's sort of the concise version of what hope theory is. As far as I know, I'm the first one to apply it to the workplace, but I have found hope to be in very short supply in many of the corporations in which I work. So I take that with me to help people be more hopeful and to feed hope into their environment. The research does show us quite a bit about high hope versus low hope people. And this is distinct from optimism or happiness. I'll explain that later if you're interested. But high hope people tend to set more goals than low hope people. They set goals that are more ambitious, that are harder to reach, and yet they are more successful at attaining those goals. And overall, high hope people have a greater level of satisfaction, less stress, more happiness. Hopeful people want to take action. The difference, big difference with optimism is it is future focused and specific. It's not everything's going to turn out okay, I hope. I mean, I'm an optimist. Any optimists in the room? It's nice to be a half full. Only problem with that is pessimists, according to the data, far more realistic and accurate than the rest of our. I'll still take the half full, but the pessimists, you need them in your midst. Listen to the naysayers. We need those bubble bursters to get us back on track. I want to share one more thing about reinventing your brand. And this is about looking at some of those habits, looking at the way we deal with people and the world and having a little bit of fun with it. Being okay to take something old, turn it on its ear, poke some fun at ourselves, and reinvent. Good job reinventing their brand. Turning it sideways, after Procter & Gamble bought this brand, which was dying, it was like your grandpa's body wash. Nobody wanted it anymore. They started to reinvent. And then, not long ago, they started this whole line of commercials. And I agree completely with what John said about video. That is the wave of the future. That is the way to go. And they have a YouTube channel dedicated to Old Spice commercials with millions of viewers because it's so funny and it's so quirky. And you talk about connecting with your customer. Women are typically the ones buying this. They get a big kick out of that, but men can see it too. And did you notice the little riff on the musical, Man Comes Home from the Sea? They kept that as a little homage and a way to make fun of themselves. And finally, I just want to wrap up with this one idea, one story for you. I mentioned that I had gone to high school in many, many places, including Japan. And I became interested in a lot of the Eastern philosophies. And this little guy is called a Daruma. And Daruma is the god of perseverance. And he's kind of this little roly-poly statue that you would buy at a shrine or a temple, typically to give to someone as a gift when they're embarking on some sort of adventure, like a new job or a baby or a marriage. And when you get the Daruma, and he has no legs because he spent 3 years praying at the riverside, and he has no eyelids because he took his eyelids off so he wouldn't go to sleep while he was praying for 3 years at the river. So anyway, you get this with these two big round eyes, and you color in one eye when you set your intention. And for me, I was 15. And by the way, you saw my baby picture, my first picture at age 6. This is the only childhood possession I have. I got one your child at 15 and have dragged this around ever since. And so this is my Daruma. You color in the eye. I wish for a pretty house, a good job, and a happy family. Pretty good. Thought that still holds up. And when I hit 40, I thought, you know, I'm kind of there. And what you do when you reach your intention, you color in the other eye. So when I was 40, I thought, I think it's time. And I started to color it in. And then I thought, oh, wait a minute. I'm not sure I'm all the way there yet. I think I'll just do that little pinprick and I'll just leave it there. And I think my hope is that with my dying gasp, I'll say, you know, hand me the Daruma and a Sharpie. Let me finish it up real quick. But this little guy just kind of sits on my desk and reminds me to strive, to reach for those goals, to continue to evolve and grow. And right now, I want to ask you all for just one tiny homework assignment. It will take you less than an hour over the course of a month. Everybody on board with that? And you raise your hand. Yes, you are, unless you have a medical excuse. You're on board. So here's what somebody said. The word I use is when you've been volunteered. You've been voluntold. So you've all been, you know about volunteers. You've voluntold that brand buddy of yours is now your accountability buddy. And what you have agreed to do is to have one phone call, 10-minute call, once a week over the course of the month. And the only questions you ask are, hey, what's that big brand goal? And what did you do this week to further that? So it's about the purpose and the action that you took. Your buddy's job is to simply say, I did it or I didn't do it. And your job, you guys, okay, I'm going to have to separate you in a minute, but is you take that goal and you move forward with it every week. And what this will really show you, and yes, some of you do this all the time, it's life-changing when you take this seriously. I started my first business, left the corporate world, published my first book, lost 30 pounds, got divorced all in 1 year. And it was having an accountability buddy that got me through. I've done it ever since. 15 years now I've had my own business. I've always had an accountability partner. It shows you that help is out there, that people are gracious, and that having someone to either kick you in the rear end or pat you on the back, sometimes both, is a beautiful thing. So thank you for your time, and I think we're on to questions. Thank you.